dispatches tonight, the great Railtrack sell-off. Are investors and the travelling public being told all they need to know? Today, Railtrack, the cornerstone of the new rail system, announced the price for its shares. But tonight's dispatch reveals the existence of two secret reports that cast serious doubts on Railtrack's own figures for maintaining our railway. Tonight, Dispatch's reporter Sarah Spiller travels across the country to discover the true state of the network. And the program even gets a job on the railways to raise major questions about safety on the track. That's Dispatches, a story for every rail user. Are we getting a second-class return?
Today is discount day. Britain's railway system is being sold off. Railtrack owns virtually everything on the network that doesn't move. Up for grabs, 20,000 miles of track, more than 40,000 bridges, and a complex signalling system. Railtrack say they want to create a railway for the 21st century. But tonight, Dispatches puts the Railtrack promises to the test.
There is a great deal we don't know, because the information is almost all in the possession of Railtrack.
I think a lot more information is required before we could say this without caution, that this is a good investment.
Well, I think if I'd had the money to go out and buy a 125-mile-an-hour train, I'd expect to be able to operate at 125 miles an hour.
Tonight, we go behind the Railtrack smokescreen to reveal deep concerns about the state of our railway system and an industry racked with doubts over safety. Also breaking his silence, former British Rail chairman Sir Bob Reid tells us of the huge challenges facing Railtrack.
You have got the issue of how do you control safety? How do you, when the people are not working directly for you, how do you make sure they work in a safe way? And this is a major task.
We go undercover to investigate how safety really works as a Dispatches journalist gets a job on the track with no qualifications. And we take a journey of discovery to the heart of Britain's railways to investigate whether Railtrack can take Britain's network into a new future, a future that lives up to the glossy sales pitch.
The government will soon be selling shares in Railtrack. To register for a prospectus, simply call one of the many banks, building societies or stockbrokers offering a share shop service. See the list in the national press.
Behind the glossy ads, behind the hype, Dispatches can reveal a different story. On the one hand is this, the Railtrack prospectus. On the other is this, a confidential report we've obtained, permissioned by Railtrack, which has been kept under wraps until now. What's really behind the Railtrack claims? We're off on a journey of investigation aboard the Dispatches Special.
We set out to investigate the real state of Railtrack's assets, our railway system. Pathfinder prospectus, published 2 weeks ago for potential shareholders, Railtrack put a figure on what they say are the costs of keeping the network up to scratch. But we were soon told Railtrack's official figures fell far short of the real sums that should be spent. If this information was right, the revelations could explode the Railtrack claims and cast a very different light on this sell-off. We began by hearing from users of Britain's most important service, the West Coast Main Line. Birmingham commuters are angry and frustrated at Railtrack maintenance work causing delays at Euston. Rail rage, they say, can't be far away.
People have to catch the train before the one that they really want, just to guarantee getting there on time.
my wife was complaining that I was coming back very stressed at night. It wasn't the job, I was really enjoying the job. It was the uncertainty of would I get there in the morning and would I get back at night.
So if you had Railtrack here, what would you say to them?
I'd just say get your act together. Get your act together for everybody's sake.
Joining us aboard our train, one of the country's leading railway analysts, Bill Bradshaw. He had scant comfort for hard-pressed passengers.
I think that the whole of the West Coast Main Line, that is the line from Euston to Birmingham, Manchester and Liverpool, which was last modernised 30 years ago, is really in a quite unacceptable state, remembering it is the principal railway line in this country and ought to stand in comparison with the best lines in the world. And not only is the track not in good condition, the signalling is very old, and yet, although feasibility studies are being undertaken, we still don't have dates when real money is going to be spent.
So what about the track record across the network as a whole? Is Railtrack investing enough to guarantee passengers a smooth ride in the years to come? We continued our journey, changing trains to take a trip with railway consultant Bill McMorran, going from York to London aboard Intercity. Bill McMorran has developed equipment used by Railtrack to measure the quality of the ride on trains and thus the state of track.
It's a disappointment that these trains, when they entered service nearly 20 years ago, were designed for 125 miles an hour. I've been travelling today on Intercity 125s for nearly 2.5 hours, and over that time I will have travelled at 125 miles an hour for just 10 minutes. Well, we're doing about 65 at the moment, and we haven't done much above 65 since we left Sheffield. As you see, we've had quite a bit of rough vertical ride, one or two locations where laterally we swung about a little bit. The civil engineer has obviously imposed the speed restriction, which will be a permanent speed restriction. There you are, that one was quite bad. That was a bad vertical. And another one. It's getting quite lively over this little section. About the limit that I would want to see, I don't really want to see anything getting as high as this, but this is fairly sustained, so it's uncomfortable at the moment. As you see, the whole of this run down here has been quite an uncomfortable one. I wouldn't have liked to have been sitting here writing, yet I'm in a first-class carriage, Intercity 125, I'm on my way to London, and this is not the standard of ride that I would like to see in the UK. It most certainly isn't the standard of ride that we get on a lot of European intercity routes. The ideal situation would be able to strip up miles of track and relay it, but we haven't got the money.
Back aboard our train, we travelled on to find out more about track. In particular, Railtrack's plans to renew rails. The company has said they intend to renew rails at a rate of less than 1% per year. That means it would take 125 years to renew all rail. Experts told us that this was far too low, well below the rate of European countries. We met one of BR's most distinguished civil engineers. Brian Davis was a former chief engineer for the East Coast Main Line.
You've got to be desperately concerned, haven't you? Because the end product of that is that if they persist in doing what they say they're going to do, you will end up with unsafe track or lots of speed restrictions, which will render the services, the train services, uneconomic, or you will end up with a lot of line closures.
Railtrack told us,
it is expected that the annual rate of renewal will rise towards the year 2010.
They said that rail renewal in the 70s benefited from
significant improvements in the rail manufacturing process, which substantially reduces the need for early renewal.
But Britain's only rail maker told a Commons committee that a rail life of even 90 years was too optimistic.
Even British Steel admit that this is not possible.
It's claimed that Railtrack have tunnel vision when it comes to rail renewal. We went to see another leading railway analyst, Richard Hope.
Railtrack has forecast that they're only going to replace rail at the rate of once every 125 years. That's taken over the whole network. That's a ridiculously long period of time. The average rate in continental countries is about every 30 or 40 years. So you're left wondering how on earth they could have come up with a figure of 125 years. The implication is that sooner or later they will either have to have a tremendous rail replacement program further down the road in 10 to 20 years, or else a third of the network is, or two-thirds of the network is going to go.
That's a pretty strong assertion that two-thirds of the network could be gone.
Well, I'm not asserting that two-thirds of the network would necessarily go, because that's a political decision and not a decision for Railtrack. All I'm saying is that if one has to look for an explanation as to why they should be projecting such an extraordinarily low rate of rail replacement, that is one conclusion that you can come to.
Long term, there might be concerns about parts of the network being shut down, but we've found that short term, there's growing anxiety about safety, the possibility of poor track leading to derailments. Every crash or derailment is subject to an inquiry to find the cause. But what about warnings prior to accidents? When it comes to track, some claim they've been ignored. In December, a train owned by millionaire pop music producer Peter Waterman was derailed outside London's Euston station. In February, another train was derailed just a few miles away on the North London line. But between these two events, Railtrack had been warned by an engineer that a derailment on this line was possible.
The rapid deterioration that we are seeing now is due to the vastly increased volume of traffic. This is why my concern that a derailment is likely on this line has increased recently.
4 weeks after this letter came the second derailment. Railtrack told us,
"The contractors tell us if they think that particular sections of the track are approaching the end of their economic lives."
And,
"If we receive a warning from a body such as the Railway Inspectorate, we will of course listen."
Lawrence Kramer is a union official who has studied recent derailments. We showed him letters leaked to dispatches which voice concern about the state of track.
Notice was already being served by Railtrack internally upon themselves, if you like, that there was a defect, there was concern, and predicted a derailment. And sure enough, it happened.
So are you suggesting that warnings have been ignored?
Yes, very clearly warnings have been ignored by Railtrack themselves and from other parties related to Railtrack.
Following an investigation into the first derailment, the health and safety executive charged with overseeing safety on the railways forced Railtrack to repair track around Euston. Railtrack told us,
"We will do whatever track work is necessary to allow train services to run as our customers wish."
But one of their customers, Freightliner, would beg to differ. In a letter dispatches has obtained, they complain about track work on the North London line. They say it means they can't operate a punctual train service and are now in danger of losing established customers' accounts. This February, they criticised Railtrack for
not foreseeing or planning the work so as to minimise service disruption.